Okay, so yeah, we talked about how 2D EEG is formed here and how important is the thickness of aluminium gallium nitride layer, because thickness decides the interface quality. Thickness also decides how many or what is the charge density you are going to have in this quantum well. But once that is set, once you have decided on your process, you have figured out that, you know, for this thickness you get a good quality and you get a reasonable 2D EEG charge, then basically that is what device manufacturers will do. So they'll play around, they'll experiment as to what aluminium gallium nitride thickness works for them, for the gallium nitride they have at their hand, for the substrate which they are using. So below gallium nitride there is also a substrate. The substrate can be, for RF transistors, typically people use silicon carbide substrate. So gallium nitride doesn't exist like natively in nature. And it is very expensive to actually make gallium nitride. So you might remember that for silicon, people have this process to grow the silicon crystal, right? They start with a seed and then kind of have a process which can grow into a big silicon crystal. That is very, very expensive to do in gallium nitride. And therefore, they start with a substrate which is actually not gallium nitride but something else. So something else, two choices, mainly two choices. There are other choices also, but in commercial, which is heavily being used nowadays, is two choices: silicon carbide and silicon. And for RF transistors, it is silicon carbide. It turns out that silicon carbide has better lattice matching with gallium nitride. So the growing of gallium nitride on silicon carbide is slightly more quality, better quality. But silicon carbide is expensive as compared to silicon. So, but for RF transistor, it turns out that, you know, for cell phones, you can pay more. So maybe it's fine to have expensive process. But for power converters, cost is a big factor. And therefore, they don't want to go for expensive silicon carbide substrate, but they go for silicon. So this layer will be silicon for power transistors. So that is one of the difference between gallium nitride and gallium nitride power and gallium nitride RF devices. Substrate is typically silicon carbide versus silicon. So this is how this device, the different layers, and what are the thinking behind having these different layers in this device. And once you have it, then basically you apply the gate voltage, and that can control the amount of 2DG charge by varying the gate voltage, right? So if you don't apply anything, if you apply zero gate voltage, then by default there is a two-dimensional electron gas in the device. So this is a normally on device, as opposed to silicon MOSFET, which is normally off device. So normally off device, you have to apply the voltage, then you get the charge. Here you already have the charge. So you have to kind of apply the voltage to get rid of the charge. So you have to apply larger and larger negative gate voltage to make that electric field in the other direction and kind of drive away all these electrons and deplete the two-dimensional electron gas, right? So this is a normally on device. You apply the gate voltage to turn off, and if you apply even more and more positive gate voltage, you get more and more two-dimensional electron gas in the channel, right? Because now gate is kind of helping the charge formation or two-dimensional electron gas formation. And we already talked about that the material properties are such that it allows high voltage operation, it allows large current capability, and this is a structure in which you can have good mobility, because you don't need any doping. So how does gate control look like? Gate control is typically measured by transfer characteristics, or you can also do numerical simulations for two-dimensional electron gas variation with gate voltage. So this here is actually showing how does the two-dimensional electron gas charge density vary with gate voltage. So to a certain point, which is also called as cutoff voltage, there is an exponential variation, and then after that it becomes a linear variation with the gate voltage. Yeah, and we will talk actually more about these and as we talk about the model development. This is just giving you the flavor as to how the charges change with gate voltage, and this is the current with gate voltage. So this is called transfer characteristics. When you apply a very low gate voltage, you have kind of driven away or depleted the two-dimensional electron gas, therefore there is no current. And as you apply larger gate voltage, you get more and more current, because now there is more and more charge, and you can current is charge times velocity, right? So bigger charge means bigger current. So that's your transfer characteristic. So this is very similar to what you see in silicon MOSFET, except that this is a normally on device as opposed to normally off device. If I hide these axes, if I don't show you this, then you might as well say that this is exactly like a transfer characteristics of a silicon MOSFET, right? But the amount of current which this device can support, the amount of voltages which you can apply to this device is totally different, right? It's very large. And this is how the output characteristics will look like. So this is again very similar, the shape of the curves are very similar to silicon MOSFETs, that as you apply small drain voltage and increase it, the current increases, and then after a while it saturates. This is for one particular gate voltage, and if you go to a higher gate voltage, then it saturates at slightly higher level, and going on like that. Yeah, so this is very similar to normal MOSFET characteristics. And we will talk about as to what are the physical effects which make this current saturate, what are the physical effects which causes this type of behavior. So for example, if it is a ideal long channel transistor, silicon ideal long channel transistor, you see that the spacing between these two curves is kind of linear. Yeah, but if you pay attention to ideal long channel transistor, the saturation current goes like Vg minus Vt square. So the spacing between these two will actually not be linear. It will be, as you go to higher voltages, it is bigger jump and bigger jump going higher, right? So that there is a distinction, and we will talk about as to what physical effects in the device actually cause these variations, right? This is just the output and the transfer characteristics of gallium nitride transistor. So you manufacture it, and then you kind of measure it using semiconductor parameter analyzers, IDVG, to see if your transistor actually does look like a transistor, right? So this is a transistor characteristics. Now, like I said, that in this one we will just cover few key manufacturing steps for gallium nitride HEMTs. The details of the steps actually will vary from manufacturer to manufacturer, but these are the these are the important ones which will always be there in the process. So what you start with is this type of a wafer. Now, there are companies already selling this type of wafer in which, so this is for example on silicon, and then there is a gallium nitride buffer layer, then another gallium nitride epitaxial layer, and then algon layer, right? So this whole stack is something you can buy. You can buy from few companies in Europe, few companies in US, this particular piece. Typically around 4 inch can cost easily 3,000-4,000 euros, 4 inch diameter. Yeah, you can make many devices on it, but yeah, it is relatively expensive. But if you are a big company, you may actually make this stack yourself also, right? You will grow it yourself and you will have your own control process, but this is what you start with. Now, like I said, that even without doing any doping, applying any voltage or anything, you already have a two-dimensional electron gas. Now, if you want to, on that wafer, if you want to have many devices, then you have to isolate them, right? All the devices, you want to measure them separately or make them in a circuit, connect them, they are independent devices, right? So you have to first isolate them, and therefore you do this, which is called mesa isolation or mesa etching. So you kind of create these mesas where you are going to make just one device, and there, and you can have many mesas like that. So between devices, you kind of dug these trenches where you cut the two-dimensional electron gas, right? So the devices are isolated from each other. So this is the first step. Now this RIE means reactive ion etching. So gallium nitride, the material strength is strong, so it's very hard to actually chemically etch it. Typically in silicon manufacturing process, there will be chemicals which will be which can be used to etch deep trenches in the material. But in this case, the material is very strong. It's chemically inert, more or less. So if it is chemically inert, it doesn't really, I mean, whatever chemical you, it doesn't really do anything. So you have to do this, something called as reactive ion etching. Reactive ion etching is kind of like bombarding it with ions which will knock off some of the electrons. So you make these trenches by bombarding some very high energetic ions and knocking off the atoms in that region, in that specific region. Yeah. So this is how, this is the first step. You isolate the region where you are going to make the device. The next step is you deposit metals for your source and drain connections. So that would mean that you need metal in specific regions, right? You don't want metals everywhere. You need them in specific regions. So that means that you have to do a photolith. You have to do some kind of lithography. Lithography meaning it allows you to put materials in certain regions only, not everywhere, right? That is, so this is, for example, you can do a photolithography. So photolithography is like first depositing a photoresist everywhere, exposing it to some kind of light. It can be a UV, it can be whatever source, and then that opens up regions. So the exposing will be done through a mask. So mask will allow light to go to only specific regions. When you expose photoresist through this light, only certain regions will change the property. They will either become stronger or weaker, depending on it is a positive photoresist or negative photoresist. And then you can wash those regions using chemicals. Yeah, and then you deposit metal. So then you have kind of like a selective deposition of metals. Now the details, like I said, the details of this process as to what temperature you use to do this, as to what type of chemicals you use, what type of photoresist you use, all of this is basically secrets of manufacturing companies, right? Because they are working really, really hard to optimize this. They design hundreds of experiments to make sure that, you know, the profile of this is exactly what they want, the location of this is exactly where they want, and all of those details, right? But they all will be doing this, but the details will, they can vary, and I don't think we will know the details, right? So we do this, and then next step is gate deposition. So again, this is selective metal deposition, so you have to have some kind of lithography, because you only want metal in specific area. Yeah, so first do a photoresist, then do a mask exposure to make photoresist, let's say, weaker only in that region, and then deposit the metal. So you get the gate. So this makes your transistor. But it turns out that if you just keep it like this, you know, you expose it to kind of air, then it creates a lot of defects. So you have to passivate it. So this green is a silicon nitride layer, which is used for just passivating the device. So you put silicon nitride everywhere, which is actually insulator. So you passivate the device and then open up only the areas where you actually want to connect to the device. So you open up different locations, which is gate, source, and drain. So this becomes your full HEMT transistor, right? So this process will, of course, be happening not just for this device, but if you have a wafer, then you will be doing it all through the wafer, right? You'll make many, many devices on that 4-inch or 6-inch diameter wafer. Yeah. So these are the key steps which typically foundries will have to manufacture a GaN device. Passivation and then source drain connection, gate, and then passivation for making sure that it is good. So these are the key steps, and now we change a little bit and think about. So now we know how to make this device in our lab, and what we want to do is actually use it to make this. This is a DC to DC converter from EPC, and this employs semiconductor devices. We want to employ this gallium nitride transistor in designing a converter, because we figured out that it has a lot of good properties to do a DC converter design. It can have high speed, it can have support large voltages and all of that. So how do I do that? So should I just take the device and connect whatever needs to be connected to it and then go measure how my converter behaves, which is, you can say, kind of like a trial and error, right? But like I already told you, that 4-inch wafer is costing you almost 3,000 euros, 4,000 euros, and that's without the device. That's just the wafer. So the trial and error is not a good idea, right? If you are just trying to make that device and then connect it to different things and then see if the converter works, that is not at all a good idea, because it's very, very expensive. It is very, very expensive. That's one thing. And the other thing is that it is very unlikely that you will get the performance which you would like to get from the device doing trial and error, right? There's so many things which can go wrong in getting from this device to a circuit which may contain several of these devices and then other components, right? So trial and error is a bad idea, because it is very expensive. It is expensive not in terms, just in terms of cost, but also in terms of time, right? Making the full circuit from the device is going to take much longer time if you are repeating that process. So what is the other end is to have capability to do good simulations and see the device which you fabricate, how does it behave and how does it behave in circuit, right? So you need a path to go from here to here, and the path basically has two elements which are kind of connected, but basically the same thing, that you need way to simulate. You need a way to simulate things which you want to build, and you want to have this simulation as accurate as your actual device is, right? You want to mimic, you want your simulations to mimic exactly what is happening in your fabrication process in your device. The way your device is behaving, if your simulation behaves that way, then you can connect the components for your converter much more optimally, cost-effective, time-effective manner, right? So this is a clear need for accurate circuit simulations, and circuit simulations need models for the devices which are used in the circuit. Now, in circuit, actually, there are many devices, not just GaN device, but there is inductor, there is capacitor, and there are resistors, and there may be other devices. But the most complex out of all of these is actually the semiconductor device. For others, already there have been established models for many, many years and well used, well tested and everything. But as the new devices come, that's where the challenges for modeling and simulations also rise, because the physics is not clear, the way to model it is not clear, the robustness of model is not clear. Sometimes even the regions in which device needs to be operated is also not clear. Many things which are unclear in the beginning, right? So that's the challenge, and that is, and there is a clear need for having accurate capability to do accurate circuit simulations. Yeah. So this is what our next few slides is going to cover. That how do we model this device, right? There is a clear need for the model, and what are the ways to actually model the device? Yeah, so we went from basics of device operation to how to actually manufacture the device, and then now we want to use this device to do a design, and for that we figured out that we need a way to actually do simulation, accurate simulations for the device which we are building. Yeah. So you can think about it as like a inverted pyramid type scenario, right? Device, and then a range of tools which are needed to support the application. Application design, which is like converters. Now, this is an inverted pyramid because typically the number of people working in this area will be much larger as compared to those working in this, as compared to those working in this. Because if you think about manufacturing houses, they are very few because it's very expensive to lot of resources. You need many, many machines, many, many equipment, and all of them working well. So it's very few companies who can actually make a working device, right? So very few. Then slightly larger number of people who will do this simulation and ways to actually use this manufactured device. And then even larger number of people who will actually design applications. Yeah, so this is an inverted pyramid. And we covered this aspect. We covered this aspect, basics of this aspect, that how is gallium nitride device and operation and different device design aspects as to the thicknesses and the materials of different layers. And now we are going to do this, that how do we model this device so that we can do accurate simulations. Yeah. Okay, so we already talked about from application side that what type of things are needed for a device. We want high mobility, we want high voltage capability, we want high current capability. Now let's talk about what is needed from a device model. What do we want in simulations? Yeah, what do we want? What do we need in simulations which is critical for accuracy? So one is that whatever models we created, they have to be accurate. They have to be very accurate to the characteristics which your device gives. When you fabricate it, the characteristics which your device, your model should be very, very close to it, right? So accuracy is a big requirement. Then fast. So if my simulation model takes days to simulate, then it's very bad. I mean, this becomes more or less useless, right? Because no one will just sit around waiting for some one simulation result to come up and then retweak and then again sit around for days to simulate, right? So it has to be fast. It has to be reasonably fast. Yes? Otherwise, it's useless. The model is useless if it is very slow. Then it has to be robust. Now, circuit simulations need many different types of simulations. You may do AC simulation. You may do a transient simulation. You may do a DC simulation. For RF, you may also do harmonic balance simulation. All of these are very complex algorithms to figure out properties, different properties of the circuit. For example, for power converters, transient simulation is very critical. It will tell you that what is the rise time and fall time and the power loss and all those details, right? So under all of these scenarios, the model should not fail. It should converge to a solution. That is basically the robustness of the model. If you have a model which is poorly designed, you may find that it works in DC but it fails in transient. Then again, it's useless because just one circuit will need many types of simulation: DC, transient, AC, harmonic balance, and even noise simulations, right? So robustness is also very critical, that it should not just work for a type of simulation but many types of simulation robustly. Then scalability of the model is important. Scalability means if I change the temperature conditions, if I'm designing a circuit at 25 degrees C and I want to see that how will it behave at 150 degrees C. Now, the accuracy is going to depend on how accurately have you actually captured the device behavior as the temperature changes, right? So that is model scalability with respect to temperature. There is also model scalability with respect to device geometry. You, as a designer, you might want to just simulate the scenario. What happens if I, you know, increase the width of the device? Will it help me at application or will it, you know, create a problem? Do I get an advantage or it's a bad idea? So that what if question, the model should be able to answer that question for you, because then only you can optimally use the device. Yeah. then it should be predictive. Now, predictive is actually hard to understand. So like I said, that there are many things in the device which you can change. For example, width is just one of the design parameters, but maybe we just talked about that there is a range of aluminium gallium nitride layer thickness, right? That changes the amount of charge, that changes few other things which we haven't actually talked about. But that would mean that if I have model which is predictive, then as a designer, maybe I also use this as a design parameter, that instead of manufacturing company giving me that this is my aluminium gallium nitride thickness, I tell the manufacturing company that, you know, I think that 25 nanometer is going to give me the best converter performance. Yeah, so that type of predictability is a very desirable feature, and actually that's a very difficult feature to have for everything in the model, because that makes model complex, and we will get to those, but this is just the introduction to it. And then fully featured means it shouldn't just be DC or an AC or a transient model. It should allow all different types of simulation: DC, AC, transient, noise. There are models which also allow variability. So for example, if you make one device and you make a copy of that device, those two are not going to be exactly the same. They will have some variations, because manufacturing is a complex process. If you are trying to grow 20 nanometer aluminium gallium nitride, it's not that every time you will grow 20 nanometer. You'll go 21, you will go 19, right? These things can vary. But if you don't account for those, at times it may happen that only if you design a converter and you make thousands of them, only 500 of them are working. Right? Why? Because devices are varying, converter performance is varying. Same thing for RF circuits or other things, right? So there is a need for actually allowing the simulation models allow you to do your design, that even if my device varies by certain margin. So let's say aluminium gallium nitride thickness nominal is 20 nanometer, but it is going to vary by 10%. If while you are doing the design, the model allows you that capability, that yes, go simulate by varying it, then you know that even if it varies in process, it is going to work, because that's how you designed it for. You designed it already for the variability, right? So that's another feature of advanced models which allow you to tackle that problem, right? Because that's a big cost. If 50% yield, that means half of the manufacturing cost already, you know, just gone down the drain. So you want to avoid it, and simulation models are one way of doing that. And then easy to deploy in your simulator environment. Now this is kind of like a choice question. Every company, every designer at times have their own, you know, that this is the tool they want to use and this is the way they want to use it. So it is kind of like a portability of the model, that the more portable it is, it can cater to bigger community. It is not very specific to a specific simulator, or it can only work in this one but not work in the other one. That is not a very desirable feature, right? So all of these are kind of like a wish list for a good simulation model. Yeah. So now let's see what are the different types of simulation model and how do they compare against this wish list. Yeah. So the different types of simulation models are kind of listed here. Measurement based, empirical models, even neural network based models, and three-dimensional models which are based on first principle physics, and then physics based compact or analytical models. So let's go into somewhat detail of each one of those types. Yeah. So first one is table based or measurement based models. So what happens in this model is that you make the device, you measure its characteristics, and that's it. You store those measured data in form of tables, and that's that. The simulator is going to, whenever it is simulating some voltage conditions across the device, it is going to read from the table. That's all. So let's say if I want to simulate how much current I get at VG equal to VD equal to 1 volt, the simulator is going to go read the table, figure out, okay, this is the current measured, this is what you will get. Yeah. So it's very easy to do this type of modeling. Essentially, you just measure and store those data in form of tables, and many simulators already support this type of models. Just measured data, that's it, nothing else. But there are a lot of problems. The problem is, let's say you measured at 1, but your bias condition of interest, VG equal to VD equal to 1 is what you measured, but your bias condition of interest is VG equal to VD equal to 1.5. And you never measured it. You only measured 1 and 2. So what happens in between? Simulator will just do interpolation. Right? We'll just try to interpolate this. I know this. What will happen in between? I'll try to just do some kind of an algorithm to figure out how much is that. That is very open to dependent on what is the algorithm used for interpolation. It can give you whatever result, right? A lot of variation in the result, which has which has nothing related to actual device, but it is just algorithms, right? So the accuracy can suffer quite a bit. Then the measurements always have some errors, right? So you may have current going like this smoothly, then suddenly a jump, and then like this again, right? Because of some measurement problem. That becomes part of your model in this type of thing. So your simulation will not be very smooth, but we may have little bumps which may happen in model. That actually hurts the convergence, because simulator convergence is all related to trying to find out a solution which is dependent on Newton-Raphson. If you know this Newton-Raphson, it relates to the derivatives of curves. So if the curve is, you know, has these sharp jumps, then the derivatives are very large, which are not smooth, and that creates problems in Newton-Raphson trying to find out a solution, right? So these models, the measurement-based models, are very easy. You can build them very fast because you just measure it and that's it. But then there are all of these issues to use them. Measurement accuracy, robustness. Also, it doesn't really tell you in terms of what will happen if I increase the width of the device, because then you have to actually make the device and measure it. There is no scalability with respect to width or with respect to any other parameter. You have to actually do that measurement and then use it. But this is very fast to build. You just measure it and that's your model. Yeah. Then there are empirical models. So measurement based, you see that we have this problem of spikes or bumpiness in the curve because of some measurement inaccuracy. So what people did, what if I just fit this with some curve? So let's say this is my IDVD curve. I just fit it with this third order polynomial. Yeah, polynomial just fit. I mean, if I need more, I just add one more term, fourth, fifth, sixth, nth order polynomial, I just fit it with that. So now this is smooth. Yeah, but the problem becomes that it can easily go into even 17, 18th order polynomials. One of the capacitance, the diode capacitance model used in one of the companies, at 18th order polynomial. Extremely accurate within this region where it is measured, but the moment you go beyond this, where you haven't measured, it can go like this, it can go like this, it can do whatever, right? Higher order polynomials can behave in very strange ways. So that's a problem. And extracting all of these parameters, which is A0, A1, A2, which are not linked to anything, you cannot say that it is related to channel length, it is related to mobility. There's no connection. It's just empirical function fitted to the data. So that becomes a problem. How do you extract their values? Do they have any relation with temperature? Because it's very hard to predict how this function or these parameters should change with temperature. But again, these models are relatively easy because you just apply some mathematics and fit your data. So it's easy to build, but there are these problems with predictability. There are these problems with respect to their extrapolatory behavior. So if I measure till 1 volt, and if I go to 1.1, you cannot really say how this polynomial will behave. It can go down, it can go up, it can behave in very erratic ways because of higher order polynomial, right? And that becomes a problem. The problem is that while trying to find out a solution for a bias condition or for a condition, Newton Raphson can move around, right? It will jump around, try to find a global optimal solution. But so it can jump also a little bit higher than 1 volt. The 1 volt is still the point where you measured, but it can go also a little bit higher just to find out a solution. And if in that region the model is really behaving erratically, then it throws off Newton Raphson into a totally wrong direction, which can lead to convergence problems. Right. So this is the limitations of empirical models. Then there are even models based on neural networks. So what people try to do, this is it has been in research in device modeling community. It happened some time back, and then it came back, and then once in a while you will always find papers which will try to use neural networks to do actually device modeling. Because neural networks have this property, right, that you can train them and then you can use them to predict things. And they have this property that they have smooth functions. So the derivatives will not be very sharp, and all of that aspects are good in neural network in a way. But so they design very complex neural networks. Sometimes this is one layer, this is just one hidden layer. You may have multiple hidden layer neural network. And what you do is you train so-called that network with measured data, right? You keep training it. So let's say you are trying to develop a model for drain current. You will take a lot of data, which is drain current at different VG and VD conditions, and then give this data to the network. Keep changing these weights such that for specific VG, VD conditions, the output of this network is the drain current which you measured, right? Keep changing these weights so that you ultimately train this network to do to predict the current under these specific conditions, right? It is possible, and people have already shown that yes, you can do this. But then there are several actually limitations. First of all, it becomes very complex, right? You can easily increase the complexity to 3, 4, 5 hidden layers. It becomes very complex very fast. And then again, you are totally dependent on, so any accuracy in any inaccuracy or any bump in the measured data, the network doesn't care, right? It just trains based on that. So whatever data, so for example, one of the problem which was shown in a research paper, you train a neural network, and for VDS equal to 0, because of the measurement inaccuracy, you didn't get zero current in your measured data. You get some picoamp current. So the network is going to give that picoamp current, even for VDS equal to 0. Because the network doesn't know anything about device, right? But if you come from physics background, if you come from background which you know that for VDS equal to 0, it has to be zero current, then you can force that in physics-based model, but you cannot really force those things in neural nets, right? Neural net doesn't care its device or its whatever, it just trains on the data which you supply to it. So that becomes a limitation. That's a lot of unphysical behavior can come out of it because of measurement limitations. Similarly, there is no relation to device parameters, right? If you change the channel length, if you change width, change L, you have to just keep feeding it the data and keep training it. So the complexity becomes larger and larger, and it runs into similar problems as the empirical models or as the measurement-based models run into. That scalability, training procedure is very expensive, and also many different simulators, many of them don't actually support this style of modeling. So all of those are major problems in neural network based simulation models. Then there are very accurate three dimensional first principle models. So what they will do is they will create extremely precise structure of the device, three-dimensional structure of the device in the simulator. In these simulators are also called TCAD, technology oriented computer aided design. These are called TCAD. Now, they are actually very accurate because they capture all these details of the device. So the way it works is that in this complete structure, then the structure is divided into grids, many grid points. Easily within this, you may have 10,000 grid points. Now for each of that grid point, first principle physics, which is Gauss's law, which is Schrodinger equation, which is energy kinetics of the charges, all of those are solved at each of these grid points, right? And they have to be self-consistent, right? Because so you divide this complex structure into many grid points, it can easily be 10,000 grid points, solve the first principle physics at each of these grid points, and then tell you that what is the terminal characteristics at the source, at the drain, at the gate, right? The problem, these are very accurate. I mean, if you change the device structure, they can really give you very accurate. But the problem is the computational expense is just too much. Even for simulating just one bias point, they may take 30 minutes. So these are very good, and these are actually used for doing the device design, but they cannot be used for doing circuit design. The circuit design needs many different bias conditions, many different types of simulations, many different ways to simulate the device, transient, AC, RF, many types of characteristics of the device, right? So they are very good for, if you are a device manufacturer, you would like to do these type of models because you are changing few things in the device and you want to see how does your device behave. But if you are a circuit designer, these are of not much use because if one bias point takes 30 minutes, then there's no way that you can actually use it to do circuit. Moreover, because of this thousands of grid points, convergence is a problem in these models, right? Because everything has to be self-consistent, and so thousands of points have to be satisfied to do that self-consistently, so convergence becomes a problem. But they are, nevertheless, these models are used for by device manufacturers to actually play around with device parameters to improve the device performance. But it is very hard for circuit designers to use it because of computational expense, because of robustness with respect to convergence. Yeah. And the last are physics-based compact models. So physics-based compact models are kind of like they try to balance the trade-off between computational speed versus complexity or accuracy of, you know, trying to incorporate all these nitty-gritty features of the device. They try to balance this trade-off, and they try to balance it based on simplified solutions coming from physics. So therefore they don't give up on the predictability. They don't give up on features which physically change in the device. For example, if you increase the width, you expect that yes, the current should go larger. So that feature is kind of protected by the model. If you change the aluminum gallium nitride thickness, the physics is understood that there will be more charges in 2 decks. So that feature in a simplified manner can be captured in this type of models, right? So the complexity is not as bad as TCAD simulation, but the speed is not as good as, let's say, mathematical models or empirical models, but it's kind of in between. But it suits the need which we were seeing earlier, that you need to have reasonable speed, you need to have accuracy, you need to have predictability, you need to have scalability with respect to temperature, geometry. You need to allow different types of simulators or different types of simulations like transient, AC, DC, harmonic balance for RF, right? So these are the type of models which are preferred. So for example, for silicon transistors, the industry standard models are BSIM or PSP or EKV, and all of those are physics based compact models. So they try to simplify the complex physics in the device into analytical mathematical functions which can give you the device behavior fairly fast, but still can preserve the predictability, the scalability of the model. So for silicon, for SOI devices, for now for gallium nitride, all the models which become industry standard. So this is kind of like so compact model coalition is a body which standardizes simulation models for different semiconductor technologies. They consist of many companies, companies from all over the world, and they have realized over a long period of time that indeed physics based compact models have these advantages to strike this right trade off between complexity and accuracy, and therefore even when they start the standardization process, that becomes one of the important requirements, that whatever model you are developing, it has to come from understood device physics, and then only you become a candidate for standardization, and then there is a big process which goes on for a number of years, and then you get accepted as an industry standard model, right? So overall, like we compared gallium nitride with different semiconductor devices, you can also do similar comparison for different types of models. And this is that graph. So as you move away from this, you can say kind of like an origin, that particular property increases. So if you move away from the origin, predictability of the model increases. If you move away in this direction, speed of the model increases, accuracy increases, robustness increases. Yeah. And if I look at TCAD models, the blue one, so blue ones have very large predictability, very large accuracy, but very poor speed and poor robustness. Yeah. Which is what we talked about, because of the many grid points, because of the fine physics it is trying to solve. Measurement or empirical based models have very high speed. Right? Speed is very high, but robustness, accuracy, predictability is limited. Physics based models, like trying to meet a trade-off which suits the needs which we talked about earlier, right? So again, this is similar chart. So the biggest, the guy who covers the largest area in the chart, that's probably the right candidate, because it's kind of balancing out the different aspects which is needed for circuit simulation. So you can see that physics-based models, they are not as predictable or as accurate as TCAD models, but they are okay. They are not as bad as empirical models either. Similarly, in terms of speed, they are not as good as empirical or measurement based, but they are okay. They are not as bad as TCAD. So they're trying to strike out a balance between different conflicting requirements. Conflicting requirements, for example, of speed and predictability. Right? So this is where things have moved for device models or industry standard simulation models, and this is what we will cover in coming lectures about gallium nitride transistor model. So the model which I have developed is called ASM model, Advanced Spice Model for HEMT, is actually a physics based compact model. So it is trying to strike that trade-off or the balance between speed, or accuracy, robustness, predictability, which are conflicting requirements. And now from coming on, we are going to go into more details of this model. So here is just a snapshot, just like an overview of a physics-based transistor model, that what are the different components of physics based transistor model. Now that we have kind of realized that physics based compact models is what we need for simulating our gallium nitride transistors, which we were fabricating to get circuit simulation, right? Because it checks out most of the desirable properties which we were discussing we need for simulations, right? So once we have once we have agreed that yes, physics based compact models is what we want to do, now let's go into more detail as to what are the different components of a physics based simulation model or a compact model for transistor. Yeah, and today we will end here. This is just a general slide explaining that what all are the components of physics based transistor models. Then from next lecture onwards, we'll go into this gallium nitride ASM-HEMT transistor model and explain all of those components which are parts of that model, right? So physics-based transistor model, at a high level of abstraction, can be divided into three main components. Yeah, one of them is called core model, then model for real device effects. And then some, you can say, features in the model, which we keep adding on top of it to make a model which works for all different types of simulations. Yeah. So if you think about transistor, the core of the transistor operation is you apply some gate voltage. That gate voltage creates some charge, and then you apply some drain source voltage and you transfer that charge, right? You apply some gate voltage, you create that charge in the channel, then you apply some drain source voltage and you transfer that charge between two terminals. So charge creation and then charge transport. So core model consists of these two components. This is different physics. Both of them have different physics. Charge creation is mainly about the device electrostatics, Gauss law and Schrodinger's equation, all of those physics come into charge creation. Charge transport is something else. It has to do with that mobility. It has to do with velocity saturation. It has to do with whether the transport is drift diffusion or whether the transport is ballistic, right? So there's two different types of physics which needs to be handled to actually do develop more like a core formulation. So that's the core part. We need to have some kind of calculation to actually how much charge is in the channel. Then we need some kind of calculation which tells us how fast this charge moves in the channel. So that's charge in the channel and then carrier transport. Yeah. But then in real device, many other things happen. So what are those other things? One example is these regions which I am thinking are perfect contacts may not be perfect. They may have some resistance, right? Whenever I'm trying to contact the device, that's not a perfect contact. It will always have some resistance. That's a real device effects. That is not here, but that needs to be accounted for to build the accuracy of the model. Right, that's a real device effects. That, and there are many more such effects actually. This is just one of them, right? We thought that the mobility of the carrier in the channel remains constant as we change the bias. That is also not true. If larger and larger electric field is applied, if I keep applying larger and larger gate voltage, the carriers move very close to the surface. Even a very small amount of imperfection in the surface will modulate the mobility. For lower gate voltage, when they are slightly away from that, it's fine. That's also real device effects. That is not here, but needs to be accounted for improving the accuracy of the model. And there are many, a range of such effects which have to be accounted for. Yeah. So that becomes another very important component of a physics-based transistor model, that you first figure out how much charge is in the channel, you figure out how that charge travels, but then you figure out how much is the series resistance, how does the mobility modulate, you know, how does the temperature changes things, all of those effects. So all of those are real device effects. And we are going to talk about many of these effects and how they are accounted for in this physics-based gallium nitride transistor model, right? But then if you think about these two, they only cover the current behavior. How much is the drain current for an applied bias condition? But there are many other aspects of the device, like noise. If you are doing a LNA design, then you also need to know how much is the noise of the transistor, right? I talked about simulating the variability as the simulation model, which allows me to say that current is 500 microamperes plus minus 10%, because device to device it is going to vary. That is another feature which is a very desirable feature in the model, right? So all of these additional things, you know, which are not just current and charges, but noise, variability, heating phenomena, or layout dependent effects. There are many layout dependent things. For example, if I make a device here, which is at the edge of the wafer versus in the middle of the wafer, the stress may be slightly different in the device, and therefore the mobility will be slightly different. So all of these additional, there are many of those, all of these additional features. We'll also cover a few of those, how they are handled in ASM GaN model in the subsequent lectures, right? So you can see that, I mean, developing a model which is really, which can cater to all of this is a complex task. It needs to account for many things, actually. It starts from physics, but then it has to also incorporate what's happening actually in the device, take care of all of these layout dependent, temperature dependent, and many things, variability things. And then you actually get a full model. And on top of this, you have to make sure that it remains robust, mathematically robust. It does not create convergence problems in simulators. So it becomes very complex task, actually. And this is the reason why industry standardization. So for example, FinFET technology itself came with, I guess, 28 nanometer Intel, right? 28 nanometer process was FinFET. And from that point onwards, it almost took 7 or 8 years to do an industry standard FinFET compact model. And same thing for gallium nitride. What I started is roughly 2010, and now is 2018. So it's almost 7 or 8 years which I spent to develop this model, which is now an industry standard model. And because of all of these, you know, nitty gritty complexities which you have to account for, and everything has to be self-consistent and all of these details, right? So in the subsequent lecture, this is what I'm going to talk about all of these components, how they are in this new industry standard model, and how are the real device effects, what are the different types of real device effects, and few additional features.